First of all, I think that your connection between when, in the beginning of the presentation, you were speaking about horror Bakui and horror playing. So this idea that everything has a counterpart in Bakui horror playing. When we speak about subject and object, of course, we are facing the same, so to speak, problem, which is both of language, but I think it's also a semantic problem. It's not only a problem of language. So that on the one hand, we have the world of objects, and on the other hand, the world of subjects. And I mean, if we go back to this famous sentence by Wittgenstein when he said that a subject is a limit to the world, we can also say the opposite. An object is a limit to the subject. The thing is, what kind of object or subject can we find that basically unifies both the subjective and the objective dimension? And I think that both philosophically and scientifically speaking, the most promising object of nature is life, the living being. Because the living being, and you were speaking, and I want to deepen into this idea, because in order to analyze a living being, we cannot only treat it as an object, not as a subject either, because we couldn't actually make any sense. So that this famous dichotomy between object and subject, which crosses the issue of modern philosophy and the issue of modern science, can be summarized in Descartes' famous sentence, res cogitans, the subject, and res extensa, no? The object. But life is something in between a res extensa and a res cogitans. So that actually a living being is not only a matter organized in space. A living being takes possession of its own being. It is an owner of its own life. It has this famous inherent. It is not only an objectified world. It also has possession of its own nature. So this idea of an inherent, that even the most elementary form of life, even the most elementary bacteria, has an inner world, a metabolism, a regulatory world, which makes reference to itself. It's not a spatial res extensa, objectified reality. It is something more. I think that, actually, from the point of view of philosophy, the work of Hans Jonas, this famous German Jewish philosopher who wrote the Life Principle, that's Principle 11, and his analysis, I think it's very powerful. And then I will quote Prigogine, in fact, who I think also touch this aspect. But so this distinction between object and subject, in a living being, we have both an object and a subject, Umwelt and Innenwelt, an internal world and an external world. So we cannot simply objectify a living being. And that's probably why biology is not entirely susceptible to a mathematical formulation. Because as you were saying, time is something, it's internal to the living being. So if we treat time as an external reality, as something that flows independently, how can we actually analyze how the living being is affected by time? For an electron, I mean, an electron was the same yesterday, today, and in the future. I mean, it's been the same. There is no history of the electron. Of course, there are phenomena, there are interactions, but in its identity. But a living being, and that's the key point of evolution and the evolutionary point, the evolutionary perspective, time is intrinsic. So, going back to, I'm quoting again Prigogine, how are we going to deal with biology from the point of view of physical time? Don't we need a more sophisticated approach to time? So that, and that's one of the greatest mysteries of philosophy and of science. And I think that the best experimental example to apply this idea, what time is actually biology. So that was my first comment, I mean, my second comment, sorry, it's about the intrinsic nature of time and its importance in biology, and that's probably why biology is not a science like physics and chemistry, and probably it shouldn't be a science like physics and chemistry. And then what I want to mention is related with the idea of entropy. You quoted Shannon, and of course his great contribution is how to relate information and the transmission of information with the reduction of entropy. But going back to the biological, I don't know if I should call it a metaphor or an example or whatever it is, but going back to the case of biology. So one could argue that there is more information if there is less entropy, so that the minimization of entropy leads to more information. A system with more information minimizes entropy. Mm-hmm. But what do we do with living beings, with living systems? Do they minimize entropy or do they increase entropy? So that means that in order to analyze a living system from the point of view of information, from the point of view of objectivity, we need to deconstruct the living being as to make it inert, a pure object, which minimizes entropy. But we are actually destroying what we want to study. So what can we do? We cannot use this idea of information equals less lower levels of entropy, therefore it equals lower levels of ambiguity, because in the case of life, there is an increase in entropy, and there is also an increasing degree of ambiguity, just as in consciousness. But obviously, consciousness cannot be detached from biological systems. I'm not just speaking about artificial intelligence. Probably we will have conscious computers, but what we have is conscious beings which are also living beings. So objectivity tries to minimize both entropy and ambiguity. But in order to study the human being, and not only the human being, but any living system, we need to take into account ambiguity and the increasing of entropy. So we have, I think, a conceptual problem on how to conceive of biology. That's why, although obviously I know that biology is a science that has progressed, made enormous progress, and I very much admire the work of biologists, in any case, is it enough to have only an objective approach to the living being, in which time is an external reality, in which we want to minimize entropy? Or shouldn't we go back also to some ideas in this holistic approach to science, like the ones we find in Leonardo da Vinci, in Goethe? Goethe was also a biologist, I know that's a very controversial one, but he also made contributions. Or, of course, in the case of Ilya Prigozhin and his work. So, do you think that something can be actually obtained from this perspective? Because, of course, you were mentioning, and this is my final remark, the relationship between structure and function. And it is key in physics, in chemistry, of course, the function, the way in which a compound reacts, is related with the structure of the compound. But as we go to, if we look at the scale of evolution, what we find is that the more evolved a being is, the more separated a structure and function are. I explain myself. So that when a function is more detached from the structure, we have a more evolved system. So that the function is not exclusively constrained by the structure. So that the function is not exclusively constrained by the space, by the res extens. And that's where time comes in. Yeah. Because, of course, function is time, and you said that. In the case of consciousness, we have an almost absolute, not absolute, obviously, you know that consciousness is based upon certain structures. But consciousness is not based upon this structure alone, it's a synchronization. So we have a more detached relationship between function and the structure. And in the limiting asymptotic case, and I love the word asymptote, you were mentioning these asymptotic cases, we would have an absolute detachment of function from structure. That would be some sort of pure mind.
Ideal world.
Ideal divine mind. But in any case, scientific analysis is basically founded upon the idea that we have to analyze the structure, and then the function comes out automatically. But in evolution, in the progress of evolution, in the perfection of beings, what we have is that the more detached function is from the structure, the more complex that being is. So what can we do? What kind of scientific methodology can we implement?